What is prior art when it comes to patents and the patent application process? This video is going to give you a definition of prior art, so stick around. We are starting right now. So if you're new here, my name is Dylan Adams. I am a patent attorney and author of the best-selling book, Patents Demystified, which is an insider's guide to protecting ideas and inventions used by inventors, entrepreneurs, and startups worldwide, including top universities like Harvard, Stanford, and MIT. You might also recognize me from my appearance on CNBC's hit show, The Profit, with Marcus Lemonis. This channel is all about giving you the insider information about how I help my clients on a regular basis, whether it be Fortune 100 companies, startups, or Shark Tank inventors, protect their ideas and inventions. So be sure to subscribe, click that little bell icon so you don't miss any videos. All right, let's get right into it. So to understand what prior art is, we kind of need to understand the patent application process. So there are two ways to start the patent application process. One is by filing a non-provisional patent application. And this is the patent application that you think of that is actually going to mature into an issued patent. The other way is with a provisional patent application. A provisional patent application is just a placeholder. It only lasts for 1 year. It immediately expires at the end of that year. That term can't be extended, and that's when you have to file the non-provisional patent application, which again is the one that actually sits in line, waits to be examined, and then can actually mature into an issued patent. Provisional patent applications, they aren't examined, so they don't have anything to do with prior art, and prior art isn't really applicable to them. Prior art is only applicable at the non-provisional stage. So again, you draft and file the non-provisional patent application, and it waits in line for anywhere from 1 to 3 years before a patent examiner picks it up and will do a prior art search, or sometimes called a patent search. So the broader term is prior art. A patent search is just one type of prior art. So let me explain what I mean by that. So prior art is really any technology disclosure. And a lot of times that is going to be patents. It's going to be issued patents and publications of those issued patents, or publications of pending patent applications. And that's what people talk about when they talk about doing a patent search. Patent search is just a type of prior art search. But prior art is actually a lot broader than that. There are so many more things that can actually be prior art that can be used against you during the examination process, when the examiner is trying to determine whether what you have claimed is new and non-obvious compared to what's already out there. So again, any technology disclosure, whether it's an actual product itself, whether it's maybe a blog post that talks about technology or has pictures of technology, it could be YouTube videos, it can be scientific papers. I mean, really, any type of technology disclosure can be used as prior art, assuming it was published or something that was filed before you filed your patent application. So how is prior art used in the examination process? So it's used to form rejections related to novelty and obviousness. Obviousness rejections, that's a question of what you have claimed. Is that new compared to the prior art that's out there? That being, is there one single piece of prior art that discloses everything that you have in your claims? Obviousness is a little bit different. So obviousness is a question of, would it be obvious to one of ordinary skill in the art, that being your average person who works in that technology field, to come to all the elements of your invention based on all the prior art that exists? That could be patents that are published, that are still pending, that are issued, even issued patents that have expired. It's still a technology disclosure, so it's still prior art. A patent doesn't have to be issued. It doesn't have to be still active. It could be an expired patent that could still be prior art. So any of that, can be used against you. So for obviousness, the question again is, knowing all of those things, would it be obvious to come to your invention? The way it typically works is, in your claims, you're going to have, say, elements A, B, C, and D. And the patent examiner can't find one single piece of prior art that has elements A, B, C, and D, which would be a novelty rejection if he or she could. So what the examiner will do then is, like, they'll find one piece of prior art that has, say, elements A and B, and then they'll find another piece of prior art that has elements C and D. So the examiner then will form an obviousness rejection with that prior art, saying, well, it would be obvious to come to your inventions because I have a prior art piece one and I have prior art piece two. And by combining those, you come to elements A, B, C, and D, even though no single piece of prior art has those elements. So that's what prior art is. Thanks for watching the video. Really appreciate it. Be sure to subscribe for more videos on patents and startups. And if you got some value out of this, please give it a like. And I'd also like to hear from you down in the comments, like if you have any additional questions or if you can think of any good video ideas, love to hear from you down in the comments. Thanks again for watching. We'll see you again in the next video.